Welcome back to the course. My name is Hans de Bruin. I'm a professor of public administration and management here at Delft University of Technology. My research is on complex decision-making processes in the public sector and at the intersection of the public and private sector, including various utility sectors. This lecture is an introduction to the governance of privatized or liberalized utility sectors, like transport, electricity, natural gas, or telecom. The basic philosophy of liberalization has always been very simple. There is a network and there is a service. For example, rail and transport, or electricity network and the delivery of electricity. The costs of the rollout and maintenance of a network are sometimes so extremely high that no private party is willing to invest in it, and the network is therefore in public hands. In some countries, there is an additional argument for that. Networks are strategic assets and should not be owned by private parties. In other countries, there is no problem. Other countries have no problem with networks being owned by private parties. The owner of the network should not be the one who delivers the service. So the unbundling of network and service delivery is key in the liberalization philosophy. Former incumbents that owned the network and delivered the service have been split up. One part of the incumbents' organization has developed into a network owner, the other part delivers a service. But service delivery should not be a monopoly. So the former incumbent that is now only delivering a service is faced with competitors. This is a blueprint for a greenfield situation. And we all know blueprints do not work and greenfield situations do not exist. There are many differences between sectors, many different brownfield situations. Incumbents sometimes try to hamper new parties. Business models prove to be less attractive than originally thought, but the basics of this philosophy are visible in almost all utility sectors. One of the main consequences of this philosophy is the extreme organizational fragmentation of the utility sectors, as we also explained in the animation during week one. In the old days, there was sometimes only one organization, a public monopolist that owned the network and delivered the service. Now there are many companies delivering services, and there are sometimes even competing networks, particularly in the world of internet and telecom. So there is fragmentation. But there's another thing, the convergence of utility sectors. In the old days, there were clear distinctions between, for example, electricity and transport. But now these two sectors are converging. Solar and wind energy are unpredictable sources of energy. So there might be under or overproduction. That is a problem, and the storage of electricity might be the solution. How can we store electricity? Well, perhaps the batteries of electric vehicles are the solution. And the sectors of electricity and transport are suddenly closely connected. So fragmented sectors are converging, and the result is a spaghetti-like situation. Many actors, many interdependencies, what the social scientists call a multi-actor network. As part of the assignment for week two, we showed you how to make an actor analysis. Sometimes these actors have to work together. The next step, take the transport sector with its many players, several modalities, many regions, and per modality, per region, a number of players with both public and private, with completely different interests and no central authority. No single actor is in control. There is a network of interdependencies between these actors. As said, sometimes they have to work together. From a client's perspective, for example, it's very attractive to have one pass that can be used in the whole country. But it requires cooperation between all those players. Cooperation in a multi-actor network is extremely difficult because of the many different interests. How to get actors aligned when they have conflicting interests? In the remaining part of the lecture, I will explain the essence of getting actors aligned in a multi-actor world. And I will use a very simple example, a family. A family of five, father, mother, a 19-year-old daughter, a 16-year-old daughter, and a boy of 8 years old. fragmentation. And there are probably different interests in the family. There's no central authority. Mum and dad are equals, and the eldest daughter is 19 years old, so she has blocking power. The father has a brilliant idea. He has planned a summer holiday to Italy in August next year, and he is trying to get his family aligned. Unfortunately, no one agrees with this idea. There's no support for the plan. And you will understand, pushing this idea through is a pointless endeavor. What to do? The idea is change this game from a one-issue game into a multi-issue game. Put more issues on the agenda than just a summer holiday. Just a few examples. Party rules, buying a dog, investing in more iPads, spending weekends together, the skiing holiday, pocket money. The mechanism is the agenda has so many issues that there is potential gain and potential pain for each of the players. What is the impact of a multi-issue game? Four things. First, a multi-issue game is an incentive to sit down with each other, an incentive to enter the process of cooperation. Each player knows there's something in it for me, and without cooperation, there's no perspective of gain. And believe me, once you have entered the process, it's very hard to leave the process. Second, a multi-issue game is an incentive for unfreezing. In a one-issue game, there's always the risk of an either-or situation, either in favor of a summer holiday in Italy or against a summer holiday in Italy. Now, that might easily result in a stalemate. In a multi-issue game, parties will almost automatically become more flexible because the multi-issue game forces them to play the game of giving and taking. Third, a multi-issue game has strong incentives for cooperation. How does that work? Suppose this family has had several meetings and has reached deals on each of the issues. So there is a deal on party rules. Two members like the deal, three don't. There's a deal on the dock, three agree, two don't. A deal on the skiing holiday, four proponents, one opponent. Per issue, we'll find another coalition of proponents and opponents. So there are changing coalitions. And changing coalitions create incentives for cooperative behavior. Why? You are my opponent on issue one. Normally, I would try to block you. But I know I need your support on issue two, on which we agree and will work together. Because of that, I will behave moderately when talking about issue one. Fourth, can you imagine that the conclusion of this family is that there will be no summer holiday at all, and that the father of the family is perfectly happy with that? Yes. Why? Because the father will learn during the process. There are so many issues on the agenda that there are many other ways to serve his interest, having his family together. Multi-issue processes are an incentive for learning. Back to the world of infrastructure. There's more fragmentation than before. That makes it, on the one hand, harder to cooperate. On the other hand, more organizations often means more issues, and more issues make it easier to find common ground. So when all the organizations in the transport sector have to reach consensus on one travel card, never say, "This is the card, the envisaged card, please accept it," but try to collect a series of issues. The more issues you have, the easier it is to get the parties aligned.